Hello, everybody. This is Rice Bear, and welcome to the Starry Night Landscape Photography Panel. And I'm going to let everybody introduce themselves. We lost one of our guest panelists, Greg Gibbs from Down Under in Australia, but we're going to try to bring him back. And he might be coming. He's coming back. But anyway, to my far left here, we have Ben Canales. Am I pronouncing the last name right?
You got it, Royce. Thanks a lot, man.
And next to him is Brad Goldpaint. Say something so you're on the screen.
Good. I'm saying something.
Good. Next to him is David Kingman. Say hi, David.
Hello, world.
And then next to him is Greg Gibbs from Australia. And then Jack Fusco. Am I pronouncing that right, Jack?
It's actually Fusco.
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 I love it. And Mike Berenson.
Hi, everybody.
Great. And next to him is Mitchell Prout.
Prout, yep, you got it.
And your host. I'm going to let each one of these people, starting with Ben, give a 60-second introduction and tell a little bit about who they are and give their website, et cetera, et cetera. Go for it, Ben.
Yeah, sure. My name's Ben. I've been shooting stars for about 4 years now, and it's a crazy fun pursuit. Originally from the East Coast, down by where Jack's at in Jersey. I live out here in Oregon now and love it. Website is thestartrail.com, so you can find more of my pics there. And thanks for joining us today.
Go for it, Brad.
All right, my name is Brad Goldpaint. I've been shooting stars for probably about 3 years now. I fell in love with it after leaving my job in LA and going to hike half of the Pacific Crest Trail and looking forward to the next half. I've been working on getting into a gallery set up here in Sisters. I'm going to be teaching about 8 workshops this summer and loving every second of it. Oh, super. And you can find all of my work at goldpaintphotography.com.
Great. We'll have everybody's name on the more information below the video so you know how to spell it. Greg?
Yeah, I'm Greg Gibbs. I'm from Australia, so I'm in the future for all you guys. You can find my work at capturingthenight.com. I started about 2 years ago when I brought my first DSLR camera. About a week later, I was just pointing at the night sky, hoping to pick up a few stars, and been hooked ever since.
And thanks, Greg. And to his right is Jack.
Hey, guys. My name is Jack Fusco. I live in New Jersey, which is not the ideal location for shooting the stars. But it does make me appreciate the dark skies that I do find a lot more. This past February marked about 2 years for shooting. Still really love to try to get to as many locations that I can and try to find as many locations in Jersey, which isn't always easy. But you can find all my work at jackfusco.com.
Thank you. Mike?
Hi, everybody. I've been following Brad Goldpaint's photography for about 3 years now, and I say that because it's really been a big motivator for me as far as where my passion's taken me. And in following my passion, it's just taken me straight past the sunsets and the sun rises and just straight into the dark of the night. And following some of the other photographers' work, a lot of them are you're seeing tonight, has just been a huge inspiration for me. So it's over the past couple of years, it's really been a lot of fun watching that passion turn into prints and watching those visions turn into real life. So you can see a lot of my work at my website. It's coloradocaptures.com, and I look forward to sharing a lot more of it with you tonight.
Thanks, Mike. Mitchell.
Hello, my name's Mitchell. I've been a long-term in love with the night sky and recently getting into photography, I think the same as Jack, about 2 years or so. And I think the last... I've been getting it more into actually taking night photography or shots here in the last, probably the last several months, since December. So I'm really starting to love it, and a lot of the guys on this hangout are a lot of the motivation, the inspiration that I've had in getting into it, so I appreciate it. My, if you want to see my photos, the best place to probably see the, just see like a stream of my photos is on Flickr, and you can search for me, Mitchell Prout. And if you want to interact with me, I'm available on Google+, available most times, so look forward to the hangout. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Mitchell. I'm Royce Bear. I'm the interviewer here tonight, the one that started this hangout or panel discussion. I started doing Starry Night photography about 2 years ago, so I'm a little slow on this, but I've been doing light painting of natural features for about 30 years. You can find my work on my blog, intothenightphotography.com. Intothenightphotography.com. Okay, one thing, let me show you something that, a little thing that we're going to add here tonight. And let me bring up the screen on this. This is below the YouTube. This is below the YouTube. This is below the. Okay, we're getting some echo here, but this is the site that you can go to. It's a short version. The last six characters are capital Y, little Z, big S, the number one, little F, the capital letter O. And that's also going to be just below the YouTube channel, so you'll be able to see that. Let's start out with Mike Burns. Mike, and I'm going to pull up one of your pictures and let you start discussing it, Mike. And let me get that on the screen. And do we all see that?
Yes, we do.
Okay, Mike, go for it. Tell us about this picture.
You bet. I'm Mike Berenson, by the way. And this is a picture from the Needle's Eye up in South Dakota. And I got to give some credit to David Kingman for coming up with the idea, because we knew we wanted to shoot somewhere good for the Geminids meteor shower. So we practiced somewhere else, but I don't have to get into that. But we really wanted to find somewhere good, so we threw out some good locations that we could think of, and one of the furthest ones on the idea list came from David, and it was, you know, close to 400 miles north of where I live. So, but you know, in looking at pictures, you know, the way the needles reached up into the sky and the conditions that we were looking at as far as shooting it under the vest of the meteors, it just seemed like a really good combination, and I certainly hadn't thought, you know, found anyone else that had done it, but that wasn't the point. The point was it had the ingredients that just looked like something really magical. So, you know, we put together some plans and went for it and made it happen, and a few hurdles along the way, but boy, as you can see, it really all came together for us. In the base of it, I wanted to add that you see a person at the bottom. That is David Kingman, and he's doing some light painting of those needle spires that are reaching up. And to me, that's really what makes the picture. It's not just the meteors up at the top, and the landscape is really something incredible, but that human element and adding that in the image, to me, is what really adds that level of interest that takes it to another level.
Beautiful shot. Is that Jupiter?
Yeah,
in the center.
That's correct. The bright one is Jupiter, and both Jupiter and Sirius both were kind of dancing behind the clouds, because there were some high thin clouds that were floating overhead, and that's what caused a lot of diffusion. And you know, it made it almost as wide as a moon, you would think, but it's just Jupiter and Sirius that were both doing that.
Beautiful shot. Okay, well, I'm going to pull up one of Ben's shots here, and you see that, everybody?
Oh, yeah, that one.
Woo-hoo.
Gorgeous. Go for it, Ben.
Yeah, I picked this one first because this is the first time in 4 years that I've seen a lenticular cloud at night. And not only see it there, but it got luckily lit up by the light pollution of the small resort town below. You know, we all have got our feelings about light pollution, but you kind of got to make do with what you can there. And it was really neat experience because the cloud didn't show up probably until about like 3:30, 4 a.m. And I was distracted by some other stuff going on, other spot of the sky. And I saw this like haze forming on my left. And so finally, like, I finished up doing what I was doing and turned the camera over there and like literally almost fell back in the snow when that showed up on the back of the camera. You know, it looks like a lot of posts to make that cloud shine, but it literally was just glowing in the dark from the town and the resort lights just hitting it right there. So I fired off a couple snaps. It's a 5 panorama stitch and got a few other compositions, and literally in like 20 minutes, the rising sun or approaching sun just washed the stars out and like the opportunity was gone. So it was a neat experience and definitely something I haven't seen before.
What I think is cool is you still have your trademark tent in the foreground.
Oh, yeah. You got to get the tent in there, Royce. You know that. what I'll say about that tent is it's a Hilleberg, and it's probably the coolest tent that I've ever used as my buddies. They're really expensive. But that thing's heavy, too. So of all the tent shots, I think 90% of the time I've never slept in the tent that's actually there in the picture. But I love getting those things in the picture.
Yeah. Now, how long ago was this taken?
I think like a week and a half ago.
Wow. So you were driving around in your new Land Rover?
Yeah, I wish. No, actually, I was up there in December and got completely buried in a whiteout up there. I mean, like, dumped on 6 inches. I didn't have that nice tent. I had an MSR, like, 3-season. And literally spent the whole night holding the tent from collapsing under wind and snow. And I knew, I was like, you know what, there's probably an awesome view here. And so just kind of kept that location in the back of my mind. And a friend really wanted to go snow camping, so we went up, and the night just turned amazing. So it was just the right place at the right time and just got lucky, really grateful for it.
Now that's wonderful. Well, I'm going to bring Brad up next. Let me drop this picture and bring up one of Brad's pictures. And let me get the screen share going. There, go for it, Brad.
So this is Smith Rock State Park, and this is a 12-image panorama I compiled standing in that river, which was not very pleasant. One thing that I love how many questions I've gotten from this picture. A lot of people assume that that's actually moonlight that's lighting up the rock formations in the background there, but that's actually light pollution. So, you know, I guess light pollution works in mysterious ways. Just like Ben's picture that we just saw, without that light pollution, you probably wouldn't have been able to pick up that lenticular so well.
Yeah.
Same with this rock detail. There's just maybe a few houses that are just typical farmer's housing, and they just have like a few security lights here and there, and it's actually enough just to light up somehow that back layer of the background there, and it just kind of worked out really well. You get the rising Milky Way right behind that, and I kind of chose this particular spot because it was kind of forming the white water kind of looking scene, so with a little help of light painting, you're able to bring that white kind of to life, and I think that's what really kind of draws you into this image.
So are you wearing neoprene socks and pants?
No, but that would have been a great idea. You know, you go out and you go to these places, and, you know, half the time I like to plan, but I don't really like to plan my compositions. I kind of just go there, and whatever captures me, that's what I attempt. And I was kind of just wandering around in the middle of the night like I think we all do. And I just happened to go down this little trail that eventually ended, and I ended up seeing the river, and I saw the North Star, and it just kind of all lined up as I got there. So, yeah, that was in hiking boots and wool socks and wasn't pleasant at all.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Thank you.
We're next going to pull up one of Jack's pictures, and let me bring that up, Jack. And this is in Maine, he's telling me. Can you see it? Go for it.
Okay. All right.
Go for it, Jack.
This was a nice 12-hour drive from where I live in Jersey. Went there at the end of last summer to try to find some really dark skies, and it was the first time that I was actually able to see the reflection of the Milky Way in the water, and it just totally blew my mind how beautiful the sky was there. So this shot is actually a 20-frame panoramic.
That's a lot.
It took quite a while to actually compile. It's kind of like a make a small edit, go get some coffee, there's my computer to catch up. But the first time I went to that location, which is the Bass Harbor Lighthouse, was the only time there were clouds for the few days that I was there. And then the last night of my stay in Maine, it was originally supposed to be cloudy, and I wasn't going to check the weather again because I had 12 hours to drive early in the morning. And then, I checked it in the afternoon. It totally changed to be clear. So I was like, all right. I was like, well, I guess I've got to go one more time. And ended up staying up there, and it stayed perfectly clear until like 4 in the morning when I finally decided that I kind of had to wrap it up to wake up in 4 hours and drive the 12 hours back to Jersey. But that whole night made it one of my favorite shots. Just being out there and just having that view was incredible for me.
That's definitely a neat shot. What's lighting up the foreground?
A flashlight that is still there. Somewhere in the rock.
Is it that spot? Thanks. Appreciate it.
Good. Well, next is going to be David. Let me pull up one of your shots, David. And this is a panorama. I mean, it is totally panoramic. Go for it, David.
All right. I'm David Kingham, by the way. You skipped over me. And you can find me at davidkinghamphotography.com.
Whoa. We didn't do you, did we?
No, it's all right.
Wow. Hey, well, go ahead and give your total spiel. You get another minute.
That's all right. So I've been shooting night photography for about 4 years now. And I don't know, kind of got really obsessed with it in the past 2 years. And this year I started teaching night photography workshops, and I'm trying to find really unique locations now, which you can kind of see with this image. This was taken kind of the middle of nowhere, Nebraska. It's called the Toadstools Geologic Area, and really dark skies because there's like no towns around here. And this is a cropped panorama. I actually cropped it down because it doesn't display well on the web. It's actually like over a 360-degree view. And it was actually like, I think, 38 images.
And did you shoot this with your 35mm?
Yeah, this is a 35 Rokinon.
And in the vertical position.
Yeah.
That is such a great lens for that. I think Mike uses that quite a bit for panoramas too. I'm gonna blow that up just a little bit. Let's see if I can do that, and so we can get a little bit of. Hope I didn't blow it up too far. But how does that look like on the screen?
Looks pretty good.
Over to this room. Beautiful shot.
Dave, is that a moon or a city there on the horizon?
That's like the one city that was even close to me.
Yeah, it's perfect alignment.
Thanks. Yeah, so all the foreground is actually not lit at all. It's just the magic of the D3S, which I happen to be testing for Barlow lenses, so that worked out nicely.
You've got a lot of feedback from Barrow.
From what? Now
you've gotten a lot of feedback and promotion from Barrow because of your testing.
Yeah, it's worked out really well for me.
Yeah. I'm giving you a little bit more time because I goofed up on the introductions. So apologize. You made a big life change here just a little while ago. and left your day job and went totally freelance. Is that right?
Yeah, so I guess it's been a little over a year now. I decided to go for it, and I couldn't take the corporate life anymore. It was driving me insane. So,
amazing. I think you've done a very good job. Now, how many workshops have you got scheduled this year?
We got like six, 2 to 3 day workshops, and I just started some one day workshops, like up in Rocky Mountain National Park.
Wonderful. Okay, well, I'm going to go to, thank you so much, Dave, for your patience, David. I'm going to go to Mitchell now. And let me bring up one of Mitchell's pictures. Okay, I've put two together here to take advantage of the video format. Go ahead, Mitchell.
Exactly, with the portrait lamp orientation, that works a lot better. It shows two photos that came out of the night. This photo was one that I actually still work in the corporate life myself, so yeah, I'm envious of you having left it and able to go out and do that all the time, or do this all the time. Maybe one day. You inspire me. I'm going to do it. But so this is actually a scene at a winery that my wife and I were at not too long before the December Gemini shower, and I've really been wanting, I wanted to find some water for the Gemini shower. I knew I was going to go out and shoot it, but didn't know where, and so for probably a month I was just looking out for anything I could reach and still make it to my 9-to-5 the next day. And
yeah, we know how that goes, man.
So this one was about, I live in Louisville, Kentucky. I don't think I mentioned that before, but so the light pollution is just terrible. And yeah, I was one of those people crying to Royce, oh, I just can't do the sky. So yeah, but Jack, I saw yours, and I know I think the first time that I said that to Royce, he didn't even say anything more than just send me a link to your photos. It did. I was like, okay, fine. I can do something. So I got out and, I found this lake when we were out at the winery and just headed out there. I think it was about 2 in the morning. And the one on the left, I was fortunate enough to catch 7 meteors. I would have sworn, I saw probably hundreds in the sky, but not all of them got picked up on the camera. I don't know for what reason, but probably some. Obviously a lot were out of the frame I saw, but I thought there was more in the frame. But I was still pretty happy to catch 7. With the light pollution and everything else that we're dealing with, and then catch the reflection of the trees. That was a big thing that I learned from all of you guys, really, is incorporating, a scene with the stars, not just going out and trying to find, just the sky. There's got to be an element in there also to really draw you into the photo. So I thought this lake side here was something that kind of drew me in. And the one on the right, I got to give a disclaimer. That's not a shooting star. As much as I love to say, or wish that I could say that it was, but it just had this feel to it when I saw it in the, in the camera and post. I was looking at it and I was like, "Oh, please be." No, it's not. But either way, I thought it just added a. It had a nice with the reflection. It really, I don't know, had a dreamy quality to it, especially with the star trails. With the just the night sky, it didn't have the same punches with the. At the star trails, you're kind of already going into the dream world, and with the plane giving the illusion of a meteor reflecting in the water, I really liked how that came out.
Well, Mitchell, that's great. I'm impressed that what you were able to pull off, considering the light pollution and the fact that you live in the flatland area.
Yeah, the flatland area can definitely pose a some challenges in finding interesting landscapes, especially for starry night photography. But if you look hard enough, they're around, and you may not be able to capture some Milky Way shots. Like actually, I believe it or not, the Milky Way is somewhere in that photo. It's coming up just over the middle up to the top left, but it's just too bright. You can't really see it.
Yeah.
But, thanks, Rachel.
I may not be able to use it. Milky Way like you guys, but I can still have fun with it.
Greg, I'm going to put you on next, even though I don't have photos here on the screen because we didn't know if you were going to be a panelist. I'm going to let you do a screen share, so go for it.
Yeah, so hopefully this is... Can everyone see that?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, so I thought I'd share, I guess some would call this my breakout image. And I know a lot of people, like Brad in particular, I was just blown away with the feedback that I got from Brad on this particular image. So this was taken about an hour away from my place. It's just a local man-made lake. And I'd been to this location previously just to scope out the location. I think that's fairly important sometimes so you don't stumbling around in the dark when you go back there. And I just had to wait for the Milky Way to rise. This was just a single, it's a single 2 minute exposure actually, but after 30 seconds I covered the top part of the image and let just the foreground expose. So it's a poor man sort of graduated neutral density filter, you know, just a bit of black card. And pretty happy with how it came out. Just didn't really plan the composition in terms of the trees framing the Milky Way there, but it seems to have been quite popular. And yeah,
you know your Milky Way is backwards, don't you?
Well, that's because it's on the that's because it's on the eastern horizon. I'm lucky enough in Australia here for it to rise in the east, sort of come out of the dawn sky sort of in January, and then it sort of passes directly overhead and then sets in the west sort of late November, so I can sort of shoot it for about 10, 11 months, whereas you guys sort of just get it in the south generally, in the north there, so... Yeah,
I'm moving to Australia.
Yeah, we're all moving to Australia and New Zealand.
What part of Australia are you in, Greg?
Sorry?
What part of Australia are you in?
New South Wales, same state as Sydney, but out in the country. My nearest town is about 30 miles away.
Nice.
So no light pollution whatsoever.
That's awesome.
That's great.
Greg is the only photographer here that's probably just as much of an astronomer as he is a photographer. I think he spent more money on astronomy telescopes and tracking devices than we have on our camera equipment.
Yeah, it's been a labor of love. It's just a hobby for me. I work full time. Not at it, so spend my nights away under the stars and then turn up bleary-eyed to work in the morning. But
our bosses love that.
Got understanding bosses, so that's really cool. But yeah, camera equipment starting to catch up on the telescope equipment, that's for sure.
Well, thank you so much for being here, Greg. It's really a pleasure. We'll be talking you some more on a one-to-one thing. I'm going to go to one of the photos of mine and bring it up on the screen share. Okay. This is a technical difficulties here. This is a picture I took about 20 months ago. It's only my second Nightscaper Starry Night landscape photo. This is a Milky Way in mid-August at about midnight over Jackson Lake and the Teton Range in Grand Teton National Park. This is a fisheye lens shot, 180-degree angle, diagonal, and the barrel distortion's been removed in post-production. Now, the orange glow that you see over the range on the right is light pollution from the sodium vapor street lights in the Idaho Falls metro area, about 75 miles away. and the orange glow around the central bulge over here of the Milky Way is light pollution from the town of Jackson Hole, about 25 miles away, which shows that a little bit of light pollution in the right areas can be a beautiful thing, just kind of like what happened to Ben. So let's go to Mike now, and Mike, let me pull up one of your pictures.
I love this one.
I need a producer here.
Try to explain to us how you get that effect. It's awesome.
Okay, here we go. Go for it, Mike.
Okay. So this is captured with, I believe, 45 minutes of exposure time for the stars, another 3 minutes so that I could light paint the cabin. The key for the processing, though, is rather than having one 45-minute exposure, I've got 15 3-minute exposures. And that gives me a couple of things. One is when I combine them, I get a natural form of noise reduction. But I also get the ability to process each of the 3-minute segments individually. And in this case, what I did is I took the first one and, well, I'll come back to the first one. I left it alone from an opacity perspective. So, in other words, I brought all the 3-minute segments into Photoshop with each of them being a layer that I could manipulate individually. And the top one I left alone, the next one I dropped the opacity down to 95%, the next one down to 90%, the next one down to 85%. And so by doing that, I was able to create the trailing, the tail on the comet. And this, by the way, this all follows a tutorial that David Kingham had posted that he gave me a heads up on. So after I had these pictures, I was able to bring them to life by following this process. But anyway, once I had the trailing effect on the tail, I just gave the head of the comet a little bit of a boost, and what I did is I brought that into a little plugin called Star Spikes Pro. And what that's used for is from an astronomy side, it's used to add little star spikes onto star images. And so in this case, instead of adding the visible star spikes, I just had it add a little bit of extra radius so that it could add some extra visibility on the color of the head. By doing that, in a lot of people's eyes, it brought this image completely to life. And it not only, you know, instead of having the straight lines, which were all great with the North Star, that really brought it to another level. And, you know, that in combination with the cabin, it's become my most popular image as a result. And the funny thing about it is it's as much my work as it is the result of collaboration, in that the ideas that came in, that brought this image to life, completely come from sharing of ideas with others. So to be honest with you, I love sharing that story because it's a big motivator to not keep everything close to the vest and to share with others because wonderful things come out of it.
What a great lesson. The colors of these stars, even though they're a little exaggerated, are the actual colors of the stars. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's funny because there's been a lot of talk on the web about where those colors come from. And some people think they're just artificially added, but you're right. They come from the colors that are the result of burning gases on those stars. They're not planets. And they have different gaseous makeups. Some of them are hydrogen and nitrogen and different makeups. So some of them burn hotter than the others. And in general, the blue ones are the hot ones. The red and the pink ones, those are the cooler ones, generally speaking. But it's really interesting that I love that I can manipulate my images in post-processing. But when there is an element that's based on reality, to me, that adds an extra element that has extra value to me.
That is so cool. Well, I'm going to bring up the next one of Ben's. And okay, go for it, Ben.
Yeah, so I was picking some shots, you know, thinking about conversation. And there's some shots that are more my favorite, but there's a lot more that represent an experience. And, you know, we kind of all chuckled about the shared comments about hurrying to get back to work the next day or dealing with light pollution. So maybe you guys can relate. In this one, I literally turned into a 5-year-old child after being dive-bombed by either Satan from Hell or a barn owl that screamed just like Satan from Hell. So I'm out there taking pictures, and out of nowhere, like, something from, like, Lord of the Rings Mordor comes dive-bombing, screeching at me, and it just harassed me the whole night. And the first time, like, I dropped to the ground, dropped my camera, and running into the bushes, and it took the whole night to get my nerve back to not just go running scared every time this thing came back. And then a few times, like, I had a really bright flashlight, and so I shined it up, and it just has that, like, classic owl saucer face, and it's just, like, hovering, staring at me, and would come in and out of the light, and then just occasionally, like, dive bomb and screech. So, I don't know, that one's a funny story. I've had a similar experience with porcupines and, you know, very vicious pigeons coming out of rafters. So I don't know what you guys can relate to, but every time I go out shooting, I always come back with some really strange, like, I don't know, never would have guessed this would have happened kind of thing.
So I think that's the fun of these night shoots, isn't it?
Yeah, I love the, you know, never know what's going to happen. You know, speaking of which, like, that spot is kind of like a little historic thing on the side of the road. And so not quite sure if I was supposed to be there or not, but a trooper pulls up and is like, oh, man, here we go. So, you know, I calmly walk up, make sure I identify myself in the dark. and amazingly, the trooper's like, what are you doing here? And I was like, I'm taking pictures. And she didn't seem fazed. She's like, okay, have a good night, and drove away. So that night was fun. There was a lot of surprises in it.
That's super. Okay, I'm going to bring one of yours up, Brad. Just as quick as I can. Go for it, Brad.
So this is Crater Lake National Park. Just an absolute magical place. If you have not been there yet, you really need to take a visit. And I guess the great kind of beauty behind it is that it's known for pretty dark skies, except that light pollution you're seeing on the horizon, that's actually Klamath Falls. But I was actually teaching a workshop this night, and lo and behold, right after this, you had the Aurora Borealis over Crater Lake. And, you know, it's funny because we're talking about how things happen every night, and lo and behold, somehow, you know, Aurora shows up at Crater Lake. It was pretty crazy. But I actually picked this shot instead just because I love trying to incorporate some kind of foreground that draws you to the image and kind of drives you in. And there's definitely some kind of similarities between the night sky and this ancient night sky and, you know, the ancient Crater Lake that used to be this giant volcano. And then having this ancient juniper tree that's just dangling by a thread. I swear, this thing is not going to be standing for much longer. So, I don't know, it just kind of all came together, and I think definitely taking advantage and using some light painting techniques, you can really start to bring out the foreground and the texture and the detail of your foreground elements. And, you know, sometimes you get really lucky, and you end up pulling off a few reflections of the stars in the lake, and They're there in some kind of a blurred mess. But all in all, I was really happy with this one.
So what part of the Crater Lake area is yours and what part is Ben's?
Ben's is like to the right.
Yeah, I think if you look at that landmass going to the right of the frame, where it would point to the shore, I was probably over there.
Yeah. Both of you produced some just awesome images and totally different styles, and that's what I love about this this work you're doing. Everybody's style is completely different.
Yeah, that's true. I really like your processing on this, Brad. It's like really glossy and punchy.
Thanks, yeah. Man.
It has a very dramatic look to it. Well, Jack, we're going to bring up one of yours.
Okay.
Go for it.
All right, so this shot I took actually just about 2 weeks ago, and I picked it because it's one of the first star trails that I've actually gotten to take with my new D800E, and I've just been so stoked on that camera and just the clarity of the image at a really high ISO. That's actually shot at ISO 3200. I just test printed it at 20 by 30 and it's so clean. But it was taken in Avalon, New Jersey. And one of the things that I found for shooting at night here is that it's actually almost kind of seasonal. A lot of these barrier islands in Jersey are pretty empty for the winter and early spring months. So I get to travel down there and kind of hang out, occasionally see a cop car and get questioned for why I'm just hanging out in the dark by myself. Most of the time they don't understand why I just want to hang out on the beach with my camera, but they let me kind of go on my way.
Kind of voyeurism, isn't it?
Well, I guess luckily that no one's there, so they don't really worry about that too much. But that area in particular has been one of my favorites to go shoot in. There's been out, nobody there, and especially after Hurricane Sandy, where people are in these shore areas. So it's a little bit of a treat and end of a disaster.
I don't want to get too much into nuts and bolts, but I like your technique here, how you've got both star trails and you've incorporated a little bit of what Mike and David have done with the end of the star trails, but then you've also got an exposure of the Milky Way behind that or through that. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. Actually, the shot that has kind of the points for the trails and the Milky Way is the same image, and they were all shot the same. And that just comes down to processing in the end, where I'll stack all the shots for the star trails and then take that one last shot that has where you see the Milky Way and the kind of the points for the trails, and then just layer that separately. And it's still something I'm working on a little bit because it seems to be different each time I try to do it. But it takes a little bit of messing around, but I was happy with how it ended up coming out.
Oh, super shot, especially considering the conditions there. Okay, well, next up we're going to do a shot of David's. And let me get down to that. This is another one in the toadstool area. Go for it.
All right. So I should have picked someone somewhere for someone else, or it's a different location, I guess, because I don't have a cool story like Ben.
Well, we know you only took two night shots. And that's the extent of your life, right?
So this was, I don't know, it was freezing cold. It was like 10 below, I think. So really great conditions, but it hurt after a while, especially after testing like six different cameras. But so this was actually like three different exposures, you know, one or two for light painting the rock formations with my favorite Xeon flashlight. It's only like $25. It's awesome. Doesn't have any hot spots. It's great. And then there's one exposure for the Milky Way. And yeah, just not a whole lot to it than that.
Well, you know what I love about this shot, David, is the texture that you've got.
Mm-hmm.
I see so many photographers who do light painting at the camera.
Yeah.
And it's so flat and lifeless, and you've gone way out to the side to do this light painting. So how did you set off the camera while you were doing the light painting?
I'm pretty close to the rocks, so I just triggered the camera. It was actually only a 30-second exposure, and just walked out to the side real quick. And I think I hit it on the right side, and then came back and hit it on the left side a little bit. And yeah, I just tried to pull out those really dramatic shadows, give it some life.
The link that I have given, people are going to be able to go up and see the texture of all these pictures and the detail at the same resolution that y'all have given them to me. So they're in for a real treat looking at these. Well, I guess the next person up is myself. Go ahead.
Real quick, though, David, what kind of flashlight do you say that was? I got a friend.
It's a Brinkman Xeon. You can find it on Amazon. I think it's $25. It's really cool.
Is that the same flashlight that you posted a picture of, like, light painting a mountain that was almost a mile away?
No, that's a different one.
All right. That was a crazy shot.
That one's mounted on the truck, right?
No, actually, that thing's really light.
That's amazing that you get that kind of power from that $25 flashlight. Is the color temperature pretty close to what you like? Because some of those LEDs are so darn blue.
There, Mike's showing it.
Yeah, this is the one. This is the light that David's talking about, a dual xenon from Brinkman.
Ah, cool.
It looks cool.
Yes.
It's got like a really natural light with some warmth to it, but it's not like that yellow you get from most flashlights. You don't have to do any correction for it. It's just awesome.
So very close to what, between 4,000 and 5,000 degree Kelvin, would you say?
Yeah, I think I usually just set it to daylight and it works out perfectly.
Oh, that's gorgeous. Thanks for showing that to us, Mike. You want to hold that up again? So some of our listening audience out there in TV land may not have seen it. Good. And let's see the front. Woo! Great.
Yep, it's got two beams. So that gives a little bit of flexibility, but it's very gentle in its light cast.
Now that's great. Hey, thanks for both of you and sharing that for us. Okay, I'm going to pull up my second image. And see if we can get the screen share going here. And I'll try to make this quick since we're running out of time. This shot was done, let's see, did that go up on screen? Is it on screen? Yeah, there it is.
Yep.
Okay. This photo was taken about 9 months ago, and Ben, this is another one of those scary nights.
Oh, I can see it, man.
Yeah. My wife was helping me out on this, and I was standing over on the right with setting up the key light, and I think three coyotes, I think that's what we could tell, there were three. They must have been only about 100 feet from them, let out the yipping and yelling. I nearly dropped my pants. So anyway, this photo was taken about 9 months ago. It's one of the first photos taken with my new Canon 5D Mark III, which I think has about two stops less noise than my older Mark II. Not that I'm going to throw my Mark II away. This is also in the Grand Teton National Park, but I had to face southeast in order to get the Milky Way so that, you know, down in Greg's country. And so you don't see the Tetons in this photo. This is the west side of this historic John Moulton barn. It's not the most popular of the two barns, but I like it. And it's to the north of the Tom Moulton barn. Anyway, this is in the Antelope Flats or area along Mormon Row. I used light painting to enhance the recognition, or you just see black silhouette bumps on the horizon. And the key light on the right, as I said, is a 100-watt incandescent modeling lamp from a studio strobe, and it's placed on the outside of the photo to the right. It's on a light stand, and so I'm not moving it around. It's just stationary. I feathered it. And on the shadow side, or the left side of the barn, is being lit by a Coleman lantern that is standing on a fence post to the far left outside of the photo. So that's my story, and I'm sticking with it.
There's a lot of atmospheric haze in that image.
Oh, I'm glad you noticed it. You know how it gives a little bit of glow to the bigger stars? And there's also some air glow in there, too. But I was so darn disappointed when this atmospheric haze started coming in, but I think it made for a better shot.
Yeah, it always adds this weird twist to your images, and it's funny too because I see so many images online and people think that that's the aurora, and then you tell them the disappointing news, no, that's actually called air glow.
Yeah. Sorry, boys.
I know.
Okay, we're going to pull up the last shot for Mike. And let me get that going here. Okay, go for it, Mike.
All right, this is a high mountain spot that I've hiked to 3 times now. The key to this is that it's in the spring, so it's high above timberline, so what little bit of light we've got was reflecting everywhere. So in the past, where I used to hike up under a quarter moon to have the ideal light, in this case I just went for it with no moon and just went for timing with the Milky Way and was hoping that a little bit of clouds would appear so it would reflect the light pollution, and that turned out to be the magic card that worked out, because the light pollution over top of those 14ers was with that lenticular cloud really made that image. And between that and the shoots in the foreground, a lot of things really came together. Technically, this is actually 11 images, one long exposure for the foreground, and 10 images for the stars. I did an interesting step where I did stacking of 10 images together. They were all relatively short exposures, and by stacking them together, I was able to improve the signal-to-noise ratio, where it makes a visible difference, not in the web image that you would see, but in the printed image. It actually really does improve the quality.
You know, I've seen so many photographers starting to do this, and of course, Greg is an astronomer. They've been doing this for years, and we're just starting to do this lower ISO stacking, you know, underexposing and stacking several images. So I think we're all going to secretly come to you and Mike and learn how you guys are doing this. Sounds like a heck of a lot of work, but the results are pretty impressive.
Well, I used a program called Registar. It's from Auriga Imaging, and in general it does 2 steps. It does something called registration, where it aligns everything up, so I don't have to worry about the fact that the stars are tracking during those 10 exposures. So it does the alignment, and then it does the merging together, and it really does have a visible result where side by side, you know, expanded up to 100%. You can see that the points of light are reinforced, but the voids between them, the dark spaces where the noise typically appears, it really does a reduction of the noise, and there's not a price to pay, so to speak, as far as either the extra gear you got to buy or the loss of detail. So I'll admit I've gotten a little lazy with it now that I've gotten a D800, but it is a technique that works.
Well, this means that a lot of photographers with less expensive cameras and a smaller aperture lens can still have a shot at this.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, when you can make the most of your gear with an extra step in the field and maybe an extra step in post-processing instead of another $1,000 in a camera or, you know, $2,000 for a big mount kind of thing that rotates with the stars. This is a way without any extra gear that you can get better signal-to-noise ratio. So it got my interest, and it's why I've been experimenting with it.
Do you think you can post a link to that, maybe a website for that software?
Sure, you bet.
Thanks.
Excellent. Okay, well, let's go to Ben now. I'll pull up your next image, Ben.
While you're pulling it up, the comment on that air glow from the shot before and talking about older generation cameras, when I first started shooting, I was using the Canon 30D, and for the longest time, I thought the air glow was like noise in the image, and I was always trying to eliminate it. And then one of the Flickr guys posted some air glow. Like, I was like, you've got to be kidding me. Like, that's, you know, it's just more amazing to the picture. And for the longest time, I was trying to get rid of that stuff, so it was a funny experience. It's cool how all this information is trickling in from so many different angles and backgrounds, whether you're a photographer, a landscape shooter, an astrophotographer, or you know all the various other hobbies that are coming at this. It's and then you put on the internet and the advancement of everything is just lightning. It's cool.
Well, tell us about this new Land Rover and how you obtained it, Ben. We've got to hear.
Sure. Again, kind of picked this shot just for a conversation point. I wish that Land Rover was sitting out front of the office right now. It's not. Props to 500 Picks and Land Rover USA. They dreamed up this idea of doing a competition for photographers to submit images based on themes for Land Rover. And the prize was you get a paid photo shoot to take a Land Rover out to go shooting according to your theme. So, you know, this, it's kind of a hotbed of a topic where sort of ingrained professional photographers are probably, or did balk at some of the with the terms of agreement or service or whatever on the competition, and also the fact that newbies are getting a chance to sort of have a chance to do a professional shoot. I think there's a lot of situations out there where it's not a good idea to sign up for it, and after looking at it, like, it just seemed like it was a good idea to go for it. And having been through the experience, not just being one of the five chosen for it, but interacting with Land Rover, getting feedback from the stuff, and the shots are going to be posting up soon next month, I really think that they really do have the photographer's interest at heart. And, you know, like a lot of people said, like, I don't want to submit photos to this competition because the terms of agreement says they can use it for, like, all these things. And truth is, like, they're not going to post our other shots on their Land Rover campaign outside of our permission. And so just want to touch on that. Like, I think a fearful stance and hesitating to engage in some of these new things that are happening online is a defensive position that might not work for you in the future. So things are changing fast, and there's bad things that you don't want to be part of, and there's good things that you should give some consideration to. So sorry for that side note. The Land Rover
thing, exactly the type of stuff I like to hear.
Okay,
not that I totally agree with everything you say, but I like the different perspective.
Sure, absolutely. So the reason I picked this shot was to kind of start the conversation of hoping that our night photography can be seen as commercially viable. I think we all know personally how quote-unquote viral the stuff that we do is online, and, you know, the comments, the feedback, and the things that we get from fans online. And I feel like while the night photography has started to trickle into the commercial market, it still hasn't seen the potential that I think is there. So I was really excited when I saw this opportunity to come up to kind of get a chance to sort of stand up for what we do and the style of photography that we do and show that, you know, there's value to the type of work that we do. And, you know, no one will probably fully appreciate how little sleep that we get on this or how exhausted we are the next day. And that effort to pay back value probably won't equal out. But I hope that through this competition, like, all of us might see a general interest of the commercial market for the type of photo works that we do. So the images are coming out here in April, and it's crazy. It's just going to be on Land Rover's Tumblr and their Facebook. Like, they're going through all this effort for Tumblr content. So, you know, that's the changing front. You know, it's not a contract for their print, for their website. It's literally for their social media content. I think it'll come out in two waves. As you guys know, some of the shots that we're probably more excited about take a lot of time to work on. So this first wave has a few that I'm really proud of, but there's a few that I've been kind of like really massaging out that will come out in the second wave that I'm looking forward to being shown. So yeah, I hope you guys like them. And it was, I can just say that it was an insane blast to just drive around and take pictures with that thing. Like, it just looks sexy under the stars. And I barely slept. I gave it all that I could, and I hope that there's more opportunity with them in the future. It was a blast.
Hey, thanks for that perspective.
That's awesome.
Hey, wait, Royce, one more thing. Just to open up a point of conversation that hopefully some others can continue. Going back to that commercial shooting at night, and I've got to be careful how I phrase this. It's very difficult to... boy, things documented online. It's difficult to be allowed to do what we do in spaces that normal commercial photography happens. If you start digging into some of the park's bylaws and also set up for commercial photography, a lot of them have exclusion for the hours of operation being from sunrise to sunset. And if you ask to shoot after that, like, smoke goes in the gears, they fall over, like, you're asking for 6 months of board review to get that permission. So hopefully, as we get more awareness of what we do, there can be some allowances to realize that we're not, you know, like, vandals in the night trying to have parties or whatever, and that we can quietly do what we do and not disturb the peace around us. But
you've brought up a very good point, Ben. I think this is because it's better to ask for forgiveness than ask for permission.
Yeah, and I don't want to say too much, so I don't have to do either. But hopefully in the future as we move forward, other people can really push this topic so that there isn't so much resistance for others as we as our cameras get more ability and as more commercial entities ask for these types of images.
You're here.
Yeah. Okay. Brad, let me make sure that this image is up for you.
Well, while you're working on that, Ben, congratulations on Land Rover. Dude,
thanks, Brad.
I couldn't think of a better person to do that, because I think you're inventing a totally new genre. Commercial landscape photography. I mean, you have this talent to put these man-made objects, whether it's tents or people around the campfire that they featured on 500 Pics for this, or now cars. So, like, what's next? Your jets, maybe? Or I don't know, man. But, dude, I was so happy for you, man, and definitely looking forward to the rest of the shots. That's
thanks,
awesome.
Dude. I appreciate it. You know, as the submissions were in, I think both of us had the top star submissions. I was like, oh, is Brad going to get them? You know, I was curious to see how it went.
Dude, so. I had nothing thanks, compared dude. To what you had, man. Yours, I mean, the way you're doing it, it's just awesome, man. So I hope that people, like, see that and they really respond to that, because it's definitely, because, you know, you're not only just advertising a product, but once these huge global brands start to see this and see that it's viable, then they'll say, okay, let's use this in our campaigns. And then when people start to see, okay, wow, look at that, that's the Milky Way.
Yeah,
and then
right.
hopefully that will eventually lead to maybe more awareness about light pollution and how we need to conserve our dark skies. So I think it's all great, man. And I hope it continues and keeps pushing forward.
Thanks, Brad. I appreciate it. That's a great attitude, man. I really appreciate it.
Definitely.
And I appreciate the dialogue here on this. Go for it, Brad.
All right. So Ben actually got to see this happen.
Yeah, that's right, from another side.
Yeah, July 13th, I think, the sun unleashed an X-class solar flare. And I was just wrapping up my latest time-lapse video. It's called Within Two Worlds. You can Google that and check it out. I went to Sparks Lake, you know, just a chance. And I said, because, you know, this was actually almost a month exactly prior to capturing the aurora at Crater Lake. And I said, you know, there's no way I'm going to get this twice, but, you know, whatever. I wouldn't be able to go to bed for a week if I didn't try this. And, you know, I just started a time-lapse sequence, and sure enough, you know, this giant, massive, explosive ray of light comes up from South Sister, which is the mountain peak on the left there, and it drifts all the way over to Broken Top, which is the mountain peak on the right, and I couldn't believe what I was seeing. I mean, you couldn't see this to the naked eye, all the color and the vivid detail, but you could actually see these beams of light coming, shooting up past the horizon, and it was just remarkable, and I pray that this won't be the last time this happens, because it's so rare to see the aurora in central Oregon. But, you know, you can see the whole sequence in that time-lapse video, like I said, but definitely just a completely unforgettable experience.
Yeah, this the only time that I've ever seen the aurora like this has been in the state of Oregon. A beautiful shot.
And maybe, you know, I always wondered, because when you go up to, say, Alaska or really far north, you see the green, right? The green colors are more common, but maybe if you're on the outskirts, that's where the pinks and the reds start to come into play. I'm not too sure, but
I think it is lower altitudes that get the different colors.
Really? Okay. That would kind of make sense.
Brad, I love how the trees, like, finger out, and then the rays finger out, and then the mountains finger out. Like, compositionally, everything just lines up in there. It's beautiful.
Yeah, you know, that's the great spot about being at Sparks Lake, because you're elevated about maybe 20 feet from the water, so then everything just kind of jets out a little bit.
Well, next up is Jack, and Jack, tell us about this image.
So I was actually torn between trying to figure out which shot to share as my last one, because I was just in Iceland recently and had a pretty crazy trip. Overall, the weather was kind of bad for photography, but in the last night, I did get to see the aurora. And like you were saying, Brad, it was very green and vibrant in the sky when I saw it. Mm-hmm. But the whole night was very interesting, because I actually ended up being rescued by the Icelandic Volunteer Rescue Squad.
This is going to be a good story.
Yes!
I was by myself, and if you're not on, like, the main road in Iceland, you're on a dirt road, which is anything other than that one road that goes around the whole island. And I was following directions and turned off into a very dark area and just slid down this whole hill of ice with no way to get back up. It's a very long story, but I'll skip ahead to this photo. I ended up choosing this photo because it was one of the first shots in Jersey that I got where I could really see the Milky Way, and it just really got me more excited about trying to do this where I live.
Yeah, let's remind everybody, this is in New Jersey, not in Iceland.
This was in Sea Isle, New Jersey. So again, it's kind of like one of those seasonal areas where not a lot of people are there in the winter, in the early spring, but just when the Milky Way starts to become visible again. And it just made me aware that, hey, if I go to these spots, there are times where I actually can see this. And it got me really excited. And also, I chose it because I took this with a Canon 7D and a Tokina 11-16 lens, which isn't exactly the most ideal setup for night photography. But I picked it because it kind of shows that you can do this without the ideal location or without the ideal equipment.
What's the f-stop on that Tokina lens?
It is a 2.8 lens.
Yeah.
That's the same one I use, actually.
It was a great lens. You know, I really did like using it, but it's not a full-frame lens. So when I switched, actually, the last or the shot from Acadia, I'd actually rented a 5D Mark III and a Canon 16-35, but ultimately ended up borrowing a friend's D800 and just loved how clean it looked. So I went with a D800E and a Nikon 14-24, which is just a killer lens. But I think Brad had actually posted a link to this to darksky.org. International Dark Sky Week is coming up April 5th or 11th. So if you follow the International Dark Sky Association, either on their Facebook page, their Twitter page, or Google+ page, anywhere that there's information posted, there's a lot we can do to help try to get rid of or make the light pollution a little bit better in these areas. And I know, like Mitchell was saying in his area, it's really tough, but there are spots you can get to. So it's worth doing something about.
So we're posting that right now so that you can all see that.
And I think almost everybody here is involved in trying to spread the word about International Dark Sky Week. It's pretty awesome.
Great cause.
Okay, I'm pulling up David's last image. Tell us a little bit about this, David.
So credit goes out to Mike on this one because he set up this shoot. We went out for an all-night shoot, and it was an awesome time up in Rocky Mountain. So that's Long's Peak in the distance there. And
I'm having some technical difficulties. Is that showing on your screen?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, good. Keep going.
All right. It's not anymore, though.
Okay. Let's see if we can figure out what the problem was. Okay.
There we go.
Is it showing now?
Yeah. So I've been, trying to think of ways to, actually incorporate, you know, typical landscape kind of elements where you use a really wide-angle lens and incorporate a nice foreground element, and which is really challenging with night photography. And, you know, this one, my lens is probably less than a foot away from the prints there. So I had to do focus stacking on this to get everything in focus. Took, four different shots, and it just turned out awesome. When I came over that ridge and saw those prints there, I was stoked.
I would have been scared.
Well, they're a lot smaller than they look. It's the wide-angle lens enhancing them.
Sasquatch. So what's giving you the glow on the stars? Is that just atmospheric conditions?
Yeah, it's just those thin high clouds, and then you've got the moon to the left of it illuminating them. We were trying to get the Milky Way, but the clouds were in the way, so that didn't work out. But
I think what makes that such a cool shot is that it's almost more of a typical, not typical in a bad way, but like a landscape photo where the foreground is more the element that you're looking at, as opposed to, like, a lot of times when we go out and shoot at night, it's all about the sky, where your photo, that still plays like a huge part of it, but it just kind of adds to it differently.
Yeah.
A lot of that.
Where did you say this was?
In Rocky Mountain National Park.
I have a picture of that same spot during the day.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome.
It is very awesome. Well, thank you. Okay, I'm going to pull up one of my shots, and I think that has everybody had three shots except for Greg and Mitchell?
Yeah, Greg owes us an Aurora shot.
Yeah.
Hint, hint.
I've got one.
Okay. Is this online?
Uh-huh.
Okay, wow. Good. It's not showing up on my screen as being online, so but as long as everybody else says it's online, that's good enough for me. Yeah. Well, this is one of those high-powered... This is for Ben's sake, you know, all the high-powered ammunition lighting equipment we're using here. I put these two vertical shots together to take advantage of the horizontal video format. I'm not trying to get another picture ahead of the rest of you. I'm sorry. And that's because they were taken only about 4 hours apart. These were taken about 4 months ago in Zion National Park in mid-November. The central bulge of the Milky Way, you know, is already dipped below the horizon. You know, we're starting to get into the winter sky. And so the central bulge is now down there where Greg lives in the southern hemisphere. So the Milky Way is a much dimmer than it is in the summer sky. And I've been so impressed that so many of you have been shooting in the winter time and really doing some great shots. The right photo was taken first. It shows the Oregon. It's light painted in the center with the Great White Throne on the left and the Angels Landing on the right. The photo on the left is of the three patriarchs. Both of these, of the foregrounds of these photos were lit with huge studio strobes. As I've said, they have parabolic or telephoto light reflector dishes, so they only have about a 15-degree angle, a spread. And they're powered by a huge lithium battery pack using a electronic inverter. And that's it.
Royce, I love the detail and crispness in your images, all of them like it's fine detail.
Well, thank you. We're pretty much here at the end. I just want to click over to Greg and let him have a few words before we close down this. We're about 14 minutes over, but I don't think anybody's feeling too badly.
I don't know. Greg always kind of bums me out when he posts pictures.
Seriously? Oh.
So, Greg, have you got another picture to screen share? Ah, there we go.
Hate you.
Is this the one you're after, Brad?
You know, just pick one. It really doesn't matter. I mean, it's all of them. Hate you.
Yeah, this was only, a week and a half ago. We had a M-class flare from the sun, and I traveled to a Mount Buffalo National Park, which is about a three-hour drive from me, and this is a lookout you can drive right up to. It's got a beautiful sort of hut there, and I think this was a 9-image panorama vertically shooting. And, you know, for everyone in the north there, we've got this is sort of the southern aurora, the aurora australis. Got the Magellanic Clouds, the large and small Magellanic Cloud there, and yeah, really
gorgeous.
Thank you.
It is so neat. Now is that the Southern Cross or the Magellan thing at the top middle?
Top middle, that's the large Magellanic Cloud. The Southern Cross is below it.
Yes.
That's the small Magellanic Cloud as well. And then over to the left, you've actually got the Southern Cross, the Carina Nebula, which is actually about 5 times bigger than the Orion Nebula. And then you've also got Alpha Centauri there, the closest star to our own sun.
Incredible. Things that we don't see in the northern sky. Well, thank you, Greg, for being here tonight. And anybody else want to give some closing words before we end this broadcast?
Thank you for hosting, Royce. Appreciate it. It's nice to get everybody together and talk about their pictures, and hope to do it again soon.
Well, thank you. We're going to end this broadcast now. I appreciate everybody tuning in, all the preparation that everybody did, and we'll do this again sometime. I'm going to do some individual one-on-one interviews first before we do another group thing. So take a look on your backside. I'll be coming up behind you and asking you for an interview.
No worries.
So adios, or how do you say that in Australia? How do you say goodbye in Australia, Greg?
Goodbye. Come on, Royce. That's good night, mate.
Good on you.
Good night.
Okay.
Cheers.
Well, thanks again, everybody.
All right.
Thank you, Royce. Have a good night.
Thanks, Royce.
Thank you, Royce.
Have a good morning, Greg.
It's afternoon here now, actually, but yeah.
It's clear we have no idea what time it is for Greg.
Yeah. Isn't it 1:17 there in the morning?
1:17 in the afternoon.
Yeah, tomorrow. In the afternoon.
Tomorrow. He's in the future.
Yeah.
Oh, gee.
Hey, guys, I did have one thing coming in. If you guys have any tutorials or anything like that that you have on your websites, I had a couple friends asking, Lance Bruin was asking for a link to your any tutorials you may have on your websites or anything that you're doing, maybe a YouTube page where you do anything like that. But if you have them, feel free to post them or maybe, Royce, maybe we could allow people a quick go here and tutorial. Just, you know, we were talking about getting people excited about night sky. I didn't know if anybody had something like that on their site.
Well, I know that David has some tutorials, don't you?
Yeah, here, I'm posting it up now. There you go.
Yeah, David's got a lot of awesome tutorials and a lot of awesome articles lately.
Thanks.
Yeah. And so we'll try to put these... capture these. Mike has put that software, and David, you put the tutorials. We'll try to all stick those at the bottom of this YouTube video, okay?
Great.
So we're going to sign off, everybody. Thank you again for being here, and it's been a pleasure. Have a good night.
Thanks, everybody.
Cheers.
Cheers.
All right.
Bye.